did this nonsense come from? That Islam came into the world at this, the Ummah of Nabi Muhammad Islam came to the world to wage endless war, to conquer the whole world and subjugate the whole world to the rule of the Ummah of Muhammad. I don't know where this rubbish came from. And they take selectively one verse of the Quran, the way schoolboys do, to build their case. But we don't have time to deal with them tonight. Allah says in the Quran that when the enemy inclines to peace, you must reciprocate. You cannot fight against an enemy who is asking for peace. Is this so difficult to understand? The Ottoman Empire had been reduced to only one city, Constantinople. The Patriarch had about 7,000 to 9,000 men to defend the city. The Ottoman army surrounded the city with 200,000 men. That's 1452. And the Constantinople, the Patriarch in Constantinople was asking for peace. We are prepared to continue to pay the tribute that we've been paying in the past. But Sultan Muhammad Fatih chose to violate Allah's command in the Quran and to wage war against an opponent which is asking for peace. And that was wrong. And that caused great injury and pain and suffering. And the conquest of Constantinople, which is coming, will be coming in order to respond to that pain and suffering imposed by what Sultan Muhammad Fatih did. Secondly, Allah makes it obligatory in the Quran that we, the Ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, must not only respect the churches and the cathedrals and the synagogues, but we must fight to protect them and the masajid. And so when the Sultan conquered Constantinople and he took the greatest cathedral of the Orthodox Christian world, Hagia Sophia, which had remained as the greatest cathedral for 1,000 years, and he transformed it into a masjid. This was a violation of Allah's command in the Quran. It was shameful. It was disgraceful. It was manifestly sinful. And we do not conduct our affairs on the basis of tit for tat. They took ours, we take theirs. Then we are just a pack of hoodlums. We have to be faithful to the guidance in the Quran and set an example for mankind. Shuhada ala nas. This is the role of the Ummah. And so it is clear that the conquest of Constantinople by the Ottoman Empire in 1452 could not have fulfilled the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. What now remains? What remains is for us to explain why there will be a conquest of Constantinople coming in the future. I know the whole of Turkey is up in arms against me. The whole of the Balkans, Albania, Bosnia, all, they're up in arms against me because of 600 years of brainwashing. But I say to them, if it is the truth, it will survive. What is the mission of this Ummah in the end time? We have an important mission. Because we are the ones who will conquer Constantinople. So the Great War is not going to destroy the whole world. No. There will be left in the world after the Great War at least this army that our Prophet praised, and the commander was praised. And this will take place after the Great War. Our brothers in Turkey, they are our brothers, and in the Balkans, they need to think again that the conquest of Constantinople by the Sultan Muhammad Fatih in the year 1453 does not qualify. Does not qualify as the prophesied conquest of Constantinople by Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. No. The conquest of Constantinople takes place after the Great War, number one. And the Great War has not taken place as yet. And number two, that once the Great War takes place, then the conquest of Constantinople and the emergence of the Antichrist in person will take place within 7 years. Since 1453 to this day, I think more than 7 years have passed. Is it possible for our brothers in Turkey to go back and think and study again? So this Ummah has an important mission. He praised the army and he praised the commander, but he never identified the name of the commander. And I don't need your help, if you don't mind. I don't need your help. He never identified the name of the commander. So if you know the name, keep your secret to yourself. I don't want it. And he praised the army. Why did he do that? Answer: because they keep on praising that army. And they keep on praising that commander to the heavens high, Sultan Muhammad Fatih. Because they are praising that army and that commander, he praises this army and this commander. Because this army and this commander will correct the wrong done by that army and that commander. Among the things that he did was to defy the command of Allah in the Quran that the believers must protect the houses of Allah. And the Quran mentions masajid, and it mentions churches, and it mentions temples, and it mentions synagogues. And you have to protect them. Surah Al-Hajj. And instead of protecting Hagia Sophia, the greatest cathedral of the Christian world, when he conquered Constantinople, he shamefully and disgracefully and manifestly sinfully converted the Christian cathedral to a masjid, to the eternal shame and disgrace of the followers of Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Those who differ with me, keep your arguments to yourself. I don't need to hear it. The Quran is my guide. Take your legal arguments and go with them. I don't need it. The law must conform with the Quran. And the Quran orders you to protect those churches and synagogues and masajid. And therefore he violated Allah's command in the Quran. So when this army conquers Constantinople, the first thing that the commander will do will be to return Hagia Sophia to the Orthodox Christians.
This is your cathedral. But I don't know when my people will learn to think. I don't know why they're so fond of eating biryani and going home to sleep. My language is a little bit harsh. You have to excuse me. But when I see my people sleeping, I'm fired up with it. How can I wake you up? When will you be faithful to the Quran? That when the Malhama occurs, the next thing that will happen will be the conquest of Constantinople. What could be the military significance of a conquest of Constantinople? And who will do it? It's a Christian-Muslim alliance that will do it. Why? Because NATO today controls Constantinople. That's why. So long as this Turkish government is in power, they can never leave NATO. Not at all. I would be tremendously surprised to see this government of Turkey making any effort to take NATO, Turkey out of NATO. That's their Islamic credentials, their so-called Islamic credentials. But the question is, what military significance can there be in a world post-Malhama, a world post-Armageddon, when the world has been devastated by nuclear war? What possible significance can there be in a conquest of Constantinople by an alliance of Muslims and Rome? Answer? There is only one answer, only one answer. That conquest of Constantinople will break the back of NATO and liberate Constantinople from the control of NATO. So Turkey will remain a member of NATO until the Malhama. When that conquest of Constantinople takes place after the Malhama, the implication would be that the Russian Navy can now pass through the Bosphorus and the Straits of Dardanelles and enter into the Mediterranean. There is no other military significance. This is the only one. And so we say to you from the world of Islam, to the Russian people, we say to you, the Russian people, from Islam, that Russia will survive the nuclear war. NATO could put that in its pipe and smoke it. Russia will survive the nuclear war. And Russia will remain a naval power. There may be no more aerial warfare after that, except perhaps the state of Israel, Dajjal's flying donkey. But Russia will remain a naval power after the Malhama. And so Russia has a tryst with destiny. Why would Allah in His wisdom ordain the conquest of Constantinople after the Malhama, so that the Russian Navy could pass through the Straits of Bosphorus, the Bosphorus and the Straits of Dardanelles into the Mediterranean, other than the Russian Navy has a role to play in the liberation of the Holy Land, in cleansing the Holy Land of this barbarian rubbish, the imposter state of Israel.
Was the conquest of Constantinople in 1452 by the Ottoman Empire, led by Sultan Muhammad Fatih, was this the conquest of Constantinople prophesied by Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam? That is the question. I wrote this book, Constantinople in the Quran. I have never seen a book on this title before. I don't know if anyone ever wrote on this subject. If not, This is the first time we have a book on the subject Constantinople in the Quran. And I had to begin this book by asking the question, was the conquest of Constantinople in 1452 the fulfillment of the prophecies? My first response, and of course I don't have to argue the case with people who have the capacity to think and who have not been brainwashed for 600 years. They can easily recognize, no, the Great War has not as yet taken place. And the conquest of Constantinople takes place after the Great War. Hence, a conquest of Constantinople that occurred 600 years ago has nothing to do with the prophecy of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Very easy for you to understand them. But for those who have been brainwashed for 600 years, it's difficult for them. So now we have to proceed a little further to try to prove to them using the Quran, not the Hadith, that now this is not the conquest of Constantinople prophesied by Nabi Muhammad. Why? He praised the army and he praised the commander. Would he praise an army which fights in violation of Allah's command in the Quran? No, that's false. He could never do that. But Allah in the Quran had given to us a code for war, a philosophy of war, a method for waging war. And in our code of ethics for warfare, we are not allowed to fight when the enemy wants peace. Even the schoolboy knows that. But those who have been brainwashed for 600 years still cannot think properly. The Ottomans wage war on an Orthodox Christian Byzantine Empire in Constantinople, which did not want war. They were so small in numbers, and this is a huge army surrounding them and they are marooned. Why would they want war? The patriarch wanted peace. He offered to pay tribute to Sultan Muhammad Fatih. In this context, the Quran prohibited you from fighting them. And the Ottoman Sultan violated Allah's command in the Quran to wage war. And hence, he could not have been the commander praised by the Prophet. And this could not have been the army praised by the Prophet. Why? We have to repeat it because they were brainwashed for 600 years. They're not like you, they can't think. He could not have been the commander praised by the Prophet. This could not have been the army praised by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, because it waged war in violation of Allah's command in the Quran. When I went to Moscow and I went to Belgrade and I said this to the Orthodox Christian world, they were pleased, oh yes, to learn that the Quran had given this order and that the Ottomans violated the order in the Quran. And so now, increasingly, alhamdulillah, many Orthodox Christians are developing a more positive attitude towards the Quran. Secondly, we say, there is additional evidence that this conquest of Constantinople in 1452 could not have been the one prophesied by Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, for a second reason. What is that? The first thing that the Ottoman Sultan did when he conquered Constantinople in 1452, I have to keep on repeating, because there are some people who are hearing this subject for the first time, because nobody teaches this subject, so you have to excuse me. That this could not have been the prophesied conquest of Constantinople in 1452 for a second reason. The first thing that the Ottoman Sultan did, Muhammad Fatih, when he conquered Constantinople, was to take the greatest cathedral. You know, you have Surau, and then you have Masjid, and then you have Masjid Jamia. Masjid Jamia, where you have the Salatul Jummah and people come from far and wide, big gathering. So too they have the church, and then they have a cathedral. Cathedral is where you have the biggest gathering. And the greatest cathedral of the Orthodox Christian world was one which was built in Constantinople, and which had functioned as the greatest cathedral for 1,000 years prior to 1452. And they called it Hagia Sophia, the receptacle of wisdom. And what he did, the Ottoman Sultan, was to take Hagia Sophia and convert it into a masjid. And those who have been brainwashed for 600 years have always accepted that what he did was okay, acceptable. And they are proud that they took the cathedral and made it a masjid. Oh yes, they don't grieve over that. And when Mustafa Kemal took over from the Ottoman Empire in 1924, shortly after that, a few years later, he and his government, the Secular Republic of Turkey, decided to close it down as a masjid, but not to return it to the Orthodox Christian, rather to convert it into a museum. Those who have been brainwashed for 600 years never looked into the Quran and never realized that the Ottoman Sultan violated Allah's command in the Quran, both in waging war on an enemy who did not want war, wanted peace, and secondly, that in the Quran Allah had declared that it is the obligation of the believers to wage war if necessary to protect the Christian church, the cathedral, the Jewish synagogue, protect it, and the masajid. This is in Surah Al-Hajj. وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْدَهُمْ بِبَعْدٍ لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامِعُ وَبِيعٌ وَصَلَوَاتٌ وَمَسَاجِدٌ يُذْكَرُ فِيهَا اسْمُ اللَّهِ كَثِيرًا إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَةِ. And so the Ottoman Sultan had a duty when he entered Constantinople to protect Hagia Sophia. Instead of doing that, he violated Allah's guidance in the Quran and transformed the cathedral into a masjid. This was shameful. This was disgraceful. This was manifestly sinful. And why should we have to wait 600 years for the world of Islamic scholarship to declare? Why? Up to this day, You have distinguished scholars of Islam who still praise the Ottoman Empire for all that they did, including conquering Constantinople in the manner they did, and also transforming Hagia Sophia into a masjid. Distinguished scholars of Islam. And you can hardly find a person, a scholar, in the world of Islam today who would denounce the Ottoman conquest of Constantinople in 1452 to have occurred in violation of Allah's command in the Quran, and who would denounce the transformation of the cathedral into a masjid in 1452, again in violation of Allah's command in the Quran. What's wrong with the world of Islamic scholarship?
I think the Turkish army is not as stupid as the president to launch an invasion of Syria. No. So it has not taken place so far. It appears that Turkey has not invaded Syria so far, and Turkey cannot invade Syria without support from NATO. So is this the credentials that you have, the supporters of the Turkish government? Is this the credentials you have? Don't you ever read the Quran? Is it not important to you that Allah has given a command in the Quran? Shall I remind you of the command? That Turkey, which is still a member of NATO, should turn to NATO and beg NATO to come and help us? Asking NATO to come and impose a no-fly zone over Idlib so that the Turkish army can invade Syria? Don't you have any shame? Don't you know what Allah has said in the Quran? But you don't care for the Quran. You don't care for the Quran, and you expect us to respect you? None of those who listen to me respect you. None of those who get guidance from me have any respect for you, because you don't have respect for the Quran. Don't you know what Allah says in the Quran? Should I remind you what Allah says in the Quran? I don't know if I'll be alive next week. So let me say it one more time. I have said it 50,000 times already, but you can't hear me. Allah speaks in the Quran in Surah Al-Ma'idah, and I have to tell it to you one more time. بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. He said, this is not mutashabiha, this is muhkama. This is plain and clear. It doesn't need any interpretation. We don't have to say Allah knows best. No, this is plain and clear, muhkam. بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Oh, you who have faith in Allah, do not take the Jews and do not take the Christians as your friends and allies. Now, don't make the mistake of taking any verse of the Quran in isolation or any part of a verse in isolation. Because you can come to the conclusion, and it'll be a wrong conclusion, that Allah is speaking about all Jews and all Christians, and saying don't take all Jews and take all Christians as your friends and allies. You would be monstrously mistaken. You'll be worse than a schoolboy. No, Allah is not doing that. You must study the Quran as a whole. That is proper methodology. Listen to the words which follow. بَعَدُوهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْدٍ. بَعَدُوهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْدٍ. Do not take such Jews, and do not take such Christians. بَعَدُوهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْدٍ. Have you heard that? Or is your skull so thick you cannot hear? Do not take such Jews, and do not take such Christians as your friends and allies. بَعَدُوهُمْ
awliya ubad, who are themselves friends and allies of each other. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. And whosoever from amongst you turn to them for friendship and alliance, you belong to them, you are no longer a part of this ummah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And Allah does not provide guidance to a wicked people. The Quran is anticipating, if I may be allowed to use that term. If it's not, then tell me what's a better term. The Quran is anticipating, the Quran is saying that a time will come when part of the Christian world and part of the Jewish world are going to reconcile and form friendship and alliance. And when that Jewish-Christian or Judeo-Christian alliance is established, as it is today, the Zionist-Judeo-Christian alliance, which has NATO as its military. Are you listening to me in Bosnia? Are you listening to me in Montenegro and Albania and Kosovo? That Judeo-Christian Zionist alliance, when it has come into being, as it has come into being, which has NATO as its military arm, Allah says, do not turn to them with friendship and alliance. So you cannot be a member of NATO. If you are a member of NATO, you no longer belong to this ummah. You join them, you're not with us. Allah will not provide guidance for a wicked people. That's what NATO is. And if you differ with me, wait for the grave and you'll see. If you have no respect for my scholarship, wait for the grave and you'll see. I'm warning you. I don't want to see you punished. I want to see you rightly guided. That's why I'm struggling and struggling and struggling with you. But not with my students, they can easily understand. MashaAllah, around the world, so many people can understand so easily that it was shameful on the part of Turkey to turn to NATO, to ask NATO to intervene so that Turkey could invade Syria. Don't you have any shame?